historic cemetery tour at 6:30 with the Undertaker. Okay. Highly recommended.
Okay.
We've got prison time!
Do something scary.
Ha ha!
touching my stuff? What are you doing?
No one ever comes to this house on the hill anymore. At least not mortal souls. It is a gloomy place, in terrible disrepair. What once were magnificent windows are boarded shut, or stare out like vacant eyes. What once was a garden is overrun by weeds and scattered white trunks of decayed trees. Better rein the horses tight and shackle the doors, for they have a second sense of intractable terror. Cobwebs hang from the walls and furniture. There's an ominous power of darkness in such a desolate house. But you don't believe in ghosts, now do you?
That it blew out windows on the other side of the island. 8 crew members died. 3 were blown into pieces. 2 were vaporized. 2 were the ones that were holding the bomb. 1 crew member flew from, it was actually on the shoreline here. They were thrown onto the top of one of the sheds of these buildings here. 2 other crew members were thrown on the other side of this hill onto the beach. They were skinned and charred, and they were alive for about an hour laying on the beach. And the only reason I tell you this story, this is absolutely true, but this is also a Halloween tour. So I have to add the gory stuff. So there's actually nobody buried underneath that obelisk. That was paid for by crew members of the Boston who were not on the ship the day they were loading ordnance. So there's nobody buried there. It's a monument. So is this one over here. So this one over here that looks like Cleopatra's Needle was actually damaged in the Napa earthquake. So you see it looks perfectly fine, but I was here the weekend after the Napa earthquake, and it was actually shifted at an angle. And that thing's held together with epoxy. The only thing holding it together right now is gravity. So Public Works crew came in and reset it. I don't know if you were here at the time. This is 2 years ago. They had caution tape and sawhorses around that thing for 6 months. So that's the condition of the cemetery. There's no money to maintain it. Look at this. Some of these tombstones you'll see are the proper height. Some of them have sunk into the mud because there's a high water table here. And this one, the Navy actually repaired this one. The only thing holding this one together is epoxy. So this one over here, the tree grew right through the grave and it is split in half. So that's why that's laying there. If you follow me, right in here, you can read those. Anybody can read Russian? So these are Russian nationals buried here. There are 6 of them here. These tombstones are only 10 years old. Now look at this guy. That's my buddy Igor right there.
Hello, Igor.
Get some pictures, bud. He's a big spider, huh? So he's hanging off the branch right there.
Oh, it's a nice fat spider. I love juicy spiders.
So these tombstones are only 10 years old, but look at the writing. These people died in 1863. During the American Civil War, the Confederacy, the Southern states, were courting foreign countries like France and England to join the Civil War on the Southern side. President Lincoln was contacting. I lost my group here. President Lincoln was contacting other foreign countries to help us out, the federal side, who won. He contacted the Tsar of Russia and he said, would you send a ship out to the United States? And they sent a ship, watch out buddy, leave that spider alone. A ship called the Bogatyr came here in 1863 on a goodwill mission. They helped put out a fire in San Francisco. San Francisco was destroyed many times before the 1906 earthquake because most of the city in the mid-19th century was built out of wood. In 1863, the financial district in San Francisco was on fire, so they sent ships from Mare Island to put the fire out to help the fire department, which was volunteer at that time. So the Bogatyr came out and helped out. Six of their crew members died in the fire. They were buried here. Our government gave them tombstones like these over here, the Federal Shield. And the original tombstones that this crew was given, paid for by our government, had Cyrillic writing on them. 10 years ago, the Russian consulate got wind of the fact that there were Russian nationals buried here. This is when the city of Vallejo, like they do today, around this area. They came out one afternoon. They just removed the ones the government gave and put these in. And as I said earlier, there's a protocol to replacing tombstones. You have to file a petition through the government. The city of Vallejo sued the Russian government for doing this. Yes, they did, because they didn't go through protocol. They replaced, they basically stole U.S. property by removing the original tombstones. We don't know where they are.
Oh my God.
Yeah, they replaced them with these. And they're not even to, you know, the specifications of the Parks Department. So these actually are reproductions of two that are over there in the middle of the cemetery. A crew called the Lena are buried over there, another Russian ship. And this is the type of tombstone that the Russian government issued their countrymen in the early 20th century and late 19th century. So this is a reproduction of a 19th century tombstone, but this is only 10 years old. There are six of them. And I had a young lady on my tour who could read these. Most of these have the person's name, but two of them just say Russian sailor. So we're going to go this way, everybody. So, as I said, people buried here did not die in battle. That's near where you all came in. There are about 20 people that died in the 1917 flu epidemic, the Spanish flu epidemic. It killed 7 million people here through epidemic, so next year she will have been dead 100 years. So, yes, I'm a very old undertaker. I have an aunt that died 100 years ago. She was two. So, where Touro is, Touro University, which is on the other side of the preserve here, they, in the back of their complex, is the old Navy cemetery, and that's where a lot of naval personnel who died in the 1917 flu epidemic died, and they're buried here. And a number of nurses are buried here, too. Only 2% of the people buried in the cemetery are female. They're either nurses who were part of the Navy, they were family members of officers who were buried here who were Navy or Marines, or they were civilian contractors whose family worked on the island. So, this is the condition of some of these tombstones, and I said, that's it. This one is repaired, but the government has no money to do the repair. The daytime is in pretty sad shape. So we're trying to do these tours just to call attention to the condition of the cemetery and to raise money for the city of Vallejo to do some work here. So the public works crew comes out, does work here. Boy Scouts come out and do some work here. Veterans come out, you know, before Memorial Day and Veterans Day and clean up the cemetery. But generally, it's not in great shape. Actually, in the 1970s and even in the 60s, they used to graze cattle here. Oh yeah. Yeah, they used to graze cattle here. So, watch your step walking through here. Would anybody like to hear some spooky stories about the cemetery in Mare Island?
Yeah.
So we're giving a Halloween tour. I do this tour on the weekends
every second Saturday from January through September, and I just give a straight history tour. I'll tell you about some spooky things I've heard of. So, I think she's here tonight. Carolyn Castro is a paranormal investigator for Soul Seekers, which is based in Vallejo. So, right by the visitor center, there's a tent there. I think she's actually in the building with the haunted house tonight. She's going to be giving some paranormal investigations starting at 7:30. But I've been doing this tour for 4 years in conjunction with Nightmare Island at night with my little lantern. And 2 years ago, I did my tour and we had a paranormal investigation right after it. So I was here for that. I'm an undertaker. I'm half dead. I have seen a few weird things and heard a few weird things only here on Mare Island, not anywhere else. When we gave the paranormal investigation 2 years ago, we had a young man who was a Civil War reenactor dressed in full kit with a black powder rifle. He fired off the rifle in the middle of the cemetery. Birds flew out of the trees, and then the paranormal investigator said all hell broke loose. Said there were orbs floating over the hills. Excuse me. A sentry ran down the hill holding a rifle. All kinds of weird things happened here, apparently. Behind us, this on the other side of this fence, the Navy owns all that land. And right past these trees are the old residence of the officers' quarters, which are still owned by the Navy, and they're closed off to us. But there's one of the houses up there from the 1890s that has apparently had some paranormal activity. I've been doing this tour for 4 years. I've had different groups. I've met people who were stationed on the island who were civilian contractors. One story I heard, and unfortunately I can't remember the, they number all these buildings, by the way. So there's one building and I can't remember the number of it, but I met two people at different times who had both lived there. One in the 1950s, one lived there in the 1960s. A two-story house. They said on the bottom floor of the house in the back there was a room that neither family ever used, because the temperature was always 30 to 40 degrees colder than the rest of the house. It was like a meat locker. And they knew something was going. They didn't believe in ghosts, but they knew something weird was going on in that room. They wouldn't even store things in it. They would just keep it closed. Also, when this area was part of the Navy, they used to build bombs right down here. The buildings that you see down here were the bomb sites where they built bombs. So, back in the 70s, there was a gentleman who was American Indian. His name was Charlie. And he was, I think he was a welder. And he was also a shaman. And the sentries used to walk up down this road, because this area was classified, it was top secret. So the sentries would guard this area. And for about a 5 to 7 year period, the different sentries would see this one girl walking up this hill on the top of the cemetery, walking along the graves and crying. So they saw her every single day. They'd chase her away. She'd come back, chase her away. And they didn't believe in ghosts either, but they knew something weird was going on because they saw her over a 7 year period. She had the same clothing on, never aged. So they knew Charlie was a shaman, and they contacted him and they said, would you go and talk to this girl in the cemetery? And you know, he figured out what was going on. Back then, in the 70s, they had records of who was buried here. They still have them. They're actually in the mailbox right there by the gate. So Charlie gathered some information about who was buried in that section, which is Section A. He came out here one afternoon. He walked up to the girl. She's walking along the graves crying. He called her out by name. He said, I don't remember what her name was, but he said, your grave is right over here. She walked over to it, sat by it, and disappeared right in front of him. This is what I've heard from several people. Also, I don't know if you know much about Mare Island, but on the other side of our gate is the Army Reserve headquarters. Then there's Touro University. Then there's Lennar. They owned all the blue homes, and they built a lot of homes in the middle of the island. And then there's industry in the middle of the island, too. So there's a powder coating company in the middle of the island. And if you saw the hearses, one of the hearses near the visitor center's mine. I bought it here in Vallejo. And when I bought it, the guy who sold it to me gave me a 700-pound iron and porcelain autopsy table. I had to get it here on a forklift. So it's in one of our storage magazines. And the guy who brought it over for me runs a powder coating company. He said, did you hear about the staff car? And I said, what staff car are you talking about? He said, I have the combination to the gate for your preserve because I have to come in sometimes. And I said, yeah. He said, 2 years ago, I had a crew open the gate because they had to come in here, and a staff car drove right by them. 1940s open staff car. And they had four officers wearing the Navy pinks. And they saluted the guys who opened the gate, drove through, and disappeared right in front of them. Yeah. Also, people say they have seen Marine sentries walking down this road. And the Navy and the Marines haven't been here for 20 years. So, yeah, we hear a lot of weird things in the cemetery. Has anybody been to Mare Island previously to before tonight?
Yeah.
Really? Did you go to the bunkers in the past? Mm-hmm. So we used to use the bunkers, right? We used to build sets in them. The city engineer came through a few months ago and said, you guys can't use those bunkers anymore. They're perfectly sound. The walls that lead into the bunkers are collapsing, so we have to seal them off. So, bunker number one is where my wife and I would do our set every year. Last year...
What is that? You mean movie plays or something?
No, the haunted house. We used to do our haunted houses in the bunkers.
Okay.
So, there are four of them just past the cemetery. So, I was opening one up last year on the first weekend of Nightmare Island, and there was nobody here but me on this end of the island. It was 4:30 in the afternoon. I opened the bunkers up, and they are pitch dark. So there's no electricity in there. We use marine batteries to light them. So I was turning all the lights on, and I was dressed like this because I'm the Undertaker. And I heard this voice behind me like this. I went, what the? And I ran out the bunker. I said, who the hell is out here? There was nobody out here. Nobody on this end of the island at that time of day. And then I got Carolyn Castro, who's a paranormal investigator, to come in with some sage and bless the bunker. She said, there's a guy sitting right in the corner of your set. I said, what are you talking about? He's sitting there on his butt with his arms around his knees. I said, there's nobody there. She said, he's right there. I said, I don't know what you're talking about. Have you been to our haunted house yet this year?
No. Yep.
So, yep. You notice when you come in, there's a gate. We lock that gate when we're not doing the haunted house, and you see all the fennel going up that road. So last Friday, when we were opening up for the day, and it was about 3:30 in the afternoon, I drove up to the gate, I was going to open it, and I looked through the fennel in the parking lot, I saw a Toyota truck driving south in that parking lot. There's no road out of that parking lot except the one I was on. So I'm thinking, one of our people is here early. And I said, hey! And the truck was moving south in the parking lot. So I opened the gate, I drove up, there was nobody in there. So there is a gravel road to go down that from that magazine to the one where the visitor center is, but it's too small for a truck, and I didn't hear it driving down the road. So that was something I saw last Friday, a truck in that parking lot, a mid-size, like a Toyota 90s truck, dark gray. I saw the bed, I couldn't see the cab. And has anybody ever seen anything out of the corner of their eye that they thought was their imagination?
Yeah. Yep.
That's happened to me a couple times, but only here, only on Mare Island. And It's pretty unusual. So if you have a chance, the preserve is open every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday from 10 in the morning to dusk. So this cemetery is open every weekend. Right past us, this road goes up to the top of the hill, about a mile up the hill. On the other side of this hill is the highest point of the island. You can see seven counties. If you are familiar with Hip Camp, which is an app for camping, you can reserve one of the yurts or bring your own tent and reserve a space to camp out here at night. So it's a lot of fun.
Any speculation on what's going on with the bodies underneath with the water table?
Yes.
You know, falling down?
The ground is sinking. I grew up near San Lorenzo. There's a pioneer cemetery right off of Highway 92 and where the Walmart is now. And that cemetery is about as old as this one. The ground is basically sinking. So yeah, they're sinking. It's sinking. So the ground here is starting to sink. So the graves are, the depressions are starting to develop.
Has anybody been dug up here?
No. No, nothing like that. No.
Just a morbid question.
Yes, sir.
Would there just be dust in there now, or would there be bones?
I've seen photographs of tree branches with skulls through them.
Oh, wow.
In the old English cemeteries, really old ones. So that happens sometime. A tree branch will grow through the coffin, and it comes up the other side. There'll be a, you know, bone attached to it. Doesn't happen here.
I saw this article where they dug up, I think it was Dr. Mengele or Billy the Kid or one of these famous people, and they opened up the coffin, and there was just like two or three bones in there. And like,
the Presidio and the Presidio pits in here. That's it. They moved all the other cemeteries to Colma. People were dying to get into Colma. So, there was, you know where the Asian Art Museum is across from the City Hall on Larkin Street in San Francisco? That used to be the Yerba Buena Cemetery. The Richmond District, on the western edge of the Richmond District, used to be a cemetery. And a lady's remodeling her basement, they found a perfectly preserved iron and glass coffin. When they dug it up, you could see the girl's face. And since they sealed it, they sealed the air into it, and she was perfectly preserved. Little blonde girl, 2 years old, all in lilacs. When they brought it to the coroner, they had to unseal it, and when the air got in, she just disintegrated. At least her features did.
Wow, that is crazy.
That happened less than a year ago. So the city of San Francisco told the woman who they found it in her basement, you have to pay for her burial. She said, I didn't know there was a cemetery here. So she contacted the mayor, and they said, okay, we'll pay for it, and it cost money. I think they buried her at the Colma Cemetery, the one where White Earp is. So it cost about $2,400 to rebury her. So the coroner, I don't know what he did an autopsy. She's been dead a long time. She's carefully preserved. Obviously, she died of natural causes. But they did. They did an autopsy, put her back in her sarcophagus. They sealed it again, and they reburied her about 4 months ago. With a, you know, with a full cemetery, full service and bagpipes and all that good stuff. So, those of you who go to our hearse con, that horse-driven hearse, that's actually used for funerals.
Oh, wow.
You know, the person is sitting there next to it is a mortician.
Don't you disrespect me, little man. Don't you derogate or deride. You're in my world now, not your world. And I've got friends on the other side.
He's got friends on the other side.
Don't worry about that. It's not a little pencil. Look, we got that little kid. Yeah, don't you worry. Sit down at my table. Put your mind at ease. Get relaxed and forgive me to do everything I please. I can read your future. I can change it around some too. I'll look deep into your heart and soul. You have a soul, don't you, Mark? Make your wildest dreams come true. I got voodoo, I got voodoo, I got things I ain't even tried. And I got friends on the other side.
We got friends on the other side.
The cards, will tell. The past, the present, and the future as well. The cards, just take three. Take a little trip into your future with me. Shake my hand. Come on, boy, won't you shake a poor sinner's hand? Yes. Are you ready?
Are you ready?
Are you ready? Transformation Central. Reformation Central. Transformation Central. Can you feel it? You're changing, you're changing, you're changing, all right. I hope you're satisfied. But if you ain't, don't blame me. You can blame my friends on the other side.
One, two, three.
Probably the trail.
Not so good. One more.
One,
two, three.
Like, let me drive, and I'm like, no, I'm okay, just let me cry. I don't know why I'm crying, but I'll find out later. And that's when I found out. So I was picking up on all that sadness. I mean, it's like, it's horrible. Yeah. I would love to get into it.
No, and then the last time I went there was a bunch of construction workers in there, and I was like, what are you guys doing? They're like, oh, they're gonna tear this out and set an apartment building here. And I was just like, excuse me? And they're all excited and taking things out, and I was just like,
apartment building?
Yeah, that's well, that was like,
oh, I guess I'll be busy for the next 10 years.
I mean,
wow.
But that's what they told me the last time I was there, and that was like maybe 3 years ago.
You know, it's Halloween. I guess everyone's entitled to one good scare.
6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face and the blackest eyes. The devil's eyes.